In this second of three lectures on molecular orbital theory, we're going to examine the MO diagrams for the second period diatomics. Let's begin. Let's start with the simplest case, homonuclear diatomic molecules. In plain English, that means we're going to continue building molecules out of two atoms of the same element. In the second period, that means we'll be placing between 2 and 16 valence electrons from the 2s and 2p atomic orbitals into molecular orbitals. The electrons from the 1s atomic orbitals are still there, but now they're core electrons, so most of the time we'll leave them out. Let's simplify this MO diagram for diatomic lithium and compare it to the MO diagram for diatomic beryllium. The 2s atomic orbitals combine to form shapes similar to those of the 1s orbitals. The lithium atoms come in with one valence electron each, giving a bond order of 1. Beryllium comes in with two valence electrons each, so we have a bond order of 0, meaning that diatomic beryllium, Be2, is not stable and will not form. Once we move past beryllium, our atomic orbitals will come with electrons in the 2p orbitals, so we need to consider how p orbital overlap will look in the molecular orbitals. If we look at the mixing of the 2p orbitals situated along the x-axis, we'll have constructive interference as shown in the lower energy wrapped candy bonding molecular orbital, where there is greater electron density found between the two atoms. We'll also form an anti-bonding molecular orbital with a node between the two atoms where no electron density is expected. Since this is a head-to-head overlap of p orbitals, we still use the valence bond theory language to describe this as a sigma overlap or sigma bond. Accordingly, we'll label the molecular orbitals as sigma 2p and sigma star 2p. In the pz and py orbitals, only side-by-side pi overlap is possible. Note that two areas of electron density show up in the pi 2p bonding orbitals, above and below the axis for each molecular orbital, and a node is still present in the pi star 2p antibonding molecular orbitals. Next, we need to consider the energy for the sigma and pi overlap of the p orbitals. Blank MO diagrams are provided here with the correct ordering of the molecular orbitals from lowest to highest energy. On the left, we have the molecular orbital diagram that is appropriate for diatomic boron, carbon, and nitrogen. On the right, we have a slightly modified molecular orbital diagram that is appropriate to diatomic oxygen, fluorine, and neon. The difference between the two are the relative energy levels of the sigma 2p and pi 2p bonding molecular orbitals. We see a pi, sigma, pi star, sigma star order for the early second period homonuclear diatomic molecules, but we see energies of the bonding molecular orbitals are reversed from oxygen to neon. Let's chat about why that happens. For reasons that are beyond the scope of this course, significant sigma 2s, sigma 2p interactions in the early homonuclear diatomic molecules cause the sigma 2p molecular orbital to go higher in energy and the sigma 2s molecular orbital to go lower in energy relative to the same orbitals in the later homonuclear diatomic molecules. It's best to memorize the order of the MOs for now. I've provided this summary of the molecular orbitals for the homonuclear diatomic molecules for your review. Our textbook has the same diagram, but I prefer the color coding here. Important points to note. 1. The valence electrons were placed in the lowest energy level first, following the off-ball principle. 2. Hund's rule was followed by half-filling same energy orbitals before filling any one orbital. 3. Molecules with lower bond orders have lower bond enthalpies. 4. Molecules with lower bond orders have longer bond lengths. 5. O2 has unpaired electrons in the MO diagram. Let's take a closer look at that. Recall that the Lewis structure and valence bond theory for molecular oxygen predicted that all of the electrons were paired, making oxygen a diamagnetic material that should be slightly repelled by a magnetic field. we saw that liquid oxygen will be trapped in the magnetic bottle formed by two strong magnets in close proximity, though, so we need a new bonding theory to explain this observation. Here, MO theory does just that by showing how we wind up with unpaired electrons in O2. To summarize what we've learned about our second period homonuclear diatomic molecules, I'd ask you to take special note of the two MOs diagrammed here. Memorize the ordering of the sigma 2p and pi 2p bonding orbitals. This is the most important idea to get out of this particular lecture. Essentially, the later homonuclear diatomics are following the rules, while boron through nitrogen force us to adjust MO theory just a little bit to capture the observed properties of these elements. Let's see if we can apply what we've learned to an example. Let's review the molecular orbital diagram for the peroxide ion, O2 2-, then use it to answer some questions. First, we see that each oxide ion is coming in with 7 valence electrons. 2 are in the 2s orbitals, and 5 are in the 2p orbitals. The 2 electrons from each 2s atomic orbital completely fill the sigma 2s bonding and antibonding molecular orbitals, so they cancel each other out. No bond is formed from the sigma 2s molecular orbitals. The 5 2p electrons fill up 10 spots in the molecular orbitals. First, we fill the sigma 2p bonding orbital with 2 electrons, then the pi 2p bonding molecular orbitals are filled with 4 more electrons. We still have 4 electrons to place, so they fill the pi star 2p antibonding molecular orbitals, leaving the sigma star 2p antibonding molecular orbital empty. All right, let's tackle those questions. A, is peroxide paramagnetic or diamagnetic? B, is the peroxide ion more stable than molecular oxygen? And C, is the oxygen-oxygen bond in peroxide shorter or longer than the bond in molecular oxygen? Here are the answers. All electrons in the MO diagram are paired, making the peroxide ion diamagnetic. B, the bond order of peroxide is 1/2 × 6−4 = 1, while the bond order of the O2 molecule is 2. This means the peroxide ion is less stable and more reactive than molecular oxygen. C, a bond order of 1 indicates a longer, weaker bond length than the one in O2, where the bond order is 2. That's it for this particular lecture. Look for the parting thoughts of the authors in the third and final lecture over molecular orbital theory.